When we consider the English canon, the first text that comes to our mind is the epic poem Beowulf, which was written around 1000 AD. But when we come to the Middle English, which is considered by many scholars as a majorly canonized poetry collection, is the poetry collection of Canterbury Tales written by Geoffrey Chaucer. As I mentioned earlier, Geoffrey Chaucer is considered as the father of English literature because he is one of the first writers to write for the people as well as critique things of his time which were very radical, and that is what happens in the Canterbury Tales. So Canterbury Tales is a collection of poems which tell us many stories about that point of time. The working date for Canterbury Tales is in the 14th century, and Chaucer was born at the perfect place at the perfect time to become a product that he was. So at that point of time, there were not much of literature written in English. So all that was written before Chaucer was either in Latin or in French or in Old English, which was Beowulf that I just talked about. Chaucer travels all of Europe, and at some point of time, he ends up in Italy. So when he ended up in Italy, there were already very good writers that were talked about in the Italian circles. So one of them is Petrarch, obviously. The second one is Dante, obviously. So Dante wrote an epic poem known as the Divine Comedy, in which there is this part called as Inferno, which is again really, really famous. Again, when we go towards these Italian writers, one of the most influential writers that Chaucer knew was Giovanni Boccaccio, who wrote this group of stories or group of tales called as Decameron. The Decameron is about few boys and girls who quarantine themselves during the Black Death in Italy, and they tell stories among themselves, and every person tells a story every day for 10 days, and every day the person who tells the best story will get a prize. So in this manner, Boccaccio invents up 100 stories, and which are really famous, and Chaucer was very much influenced by Boccaccio, and he writes up stories also in English which we call as Canterbury Tales. And also during all these journeys, he invents up an idea where pilgrims who go to Canterbury, they tell up stories, and Chaucer himself will put himself into these stories and also act as a journalist. So what Chaucer does is he goes with all of them, and then he tells all of them that this particular person has told me this tale and I am writing it. So Chaucer doesn't again directly involve himself in the stories, but he tells that he's writing a kind of a memoir or a kind of journal while he is going to that pilgrimage. The idea of pilgrimage is very much famous among the English circles. Well, it was already famous, but what Chaucer does over here is really remarkable when he involves himself in these stories in an indirect manner. So what he does is he tells that he is going along to Canterbury with an entourage or a group of people, in which he is invited, and also he writes every tale telling that he's a journalist or he's writing a memoir or a diary, if we call it in today's context. So what he does is he tells that he doesn't know anyone directly, but he is just a fellow traveler with these people. So obviously, if Chaucer is caught by the king's guards after this, after writing all these kinds of very radical ideas or radical stories, he can just tell that, oh, it wasn't me. It wasn't me at all. So these were people whom I don't even know. I was with them, so I wrote these memoirs or I wrote these journals. So what Chaucer does over here is very, very, very much intelligent as well as a very tricky task to do at his point of time. One of the major influences that Chaucer had while writing these tales was a 1381 peasants revolt in England. So what happened during this revolt was peasants revolted against the government for poll taxes which the government had imposed, and the leader of the whole expedition was Wat Tyler, who burned down all the government records, and the people who came to collect the taxes, they killed those people, and as well as they marched towards the Tower of London, where Wat Tyler was killed by a soldier from the King's Guard. So this was the simplest I could get while explaining the 1381 revolt, because again, when we talk about the 1381 revolt, it started in Essex and it went to Kent and then it came to London and all, but while discussing all of these things, that it becomes again very much intricate, as well as it becomes very difficult to understand all those threads, and we'll come back to it later when we discuss every character that Chaucer mentions in the general prologue. But one thing that is very much clear during the 1381 revolt is the peasants were not happy with the ruling of the king, and they wanted to reform the system. So Chaucer did know that there was turbulence in England, which was growing at an alarming rate. Although the peasants' revolt had been put down, there was again a possibility of another revolt which would come again crashing down to the crown. And again, as we know that the king is considered as a divine representative of God on earth, the whole system of monarchy would again be in disarray if another revolt again arises. So Chaucer is very much acutely aware of every single revolt and every single turbulence that is happening in the society at that point of time. Not much is known about how people were like in England in the 1350s and 1360s and 1370s, because all those texts that remain from that point of time were the religious texts which were written in Latin. English was not a official language as it is now. French was a court language which was used, and English became a court language when Henry VIII came to the throne. Also, people who spoke French, they were considered as people of high honor. We would see Chaucer again satirizing that when he mentions about the nun prioress who again tries to speak in French, but she cannot. She only speaks French just to show off to people. This is very, very of a Horatian satire that again Chaucer makes. We'll come back to that when we discuss the nun prioress's character in the general prologue. Two things that the church people wrote about the Englishmen in the 1350s and 1360s were that the first thing is that these people, the English people, stink a lot, though these people don't bath, and these people have an idea that if they bath, their skin will come off and then they'll die. There is no proper sanitation in whole of England. So this is again the improper sanitation in England is one of the greatest causes of the Black Death, which wreaked havoc in all over Europe and mostly also in England. The second thing that these church people wrote, that these Englishmen had a strange dialect that looked like, that again sounded like German, but they spoke French in these economic districts, and people of high honor, they spoke in French, but all those common folk spoke in a strange language that was really, really disgusting. So these were the words that the church people wrote about England. So again, these kinds of ideas, Chaucer knew them really well, and he had to take a decision of which language was he to write the Canterbury Tales. So he had three or four choices. So the first choice was in Latin. So obviously he couldn't write in Latin because he always wanted to make fun of church and he wanted to critique the church, which we will see when we move towards the lines of the general prologue. Obviously the characters of Friar, the Monk, the Summoner, the Pardoner, all these characters are literal criticism of the church. So he couldn't obviously write in Latin. The second choice that he had was French, but again he wanted to make fun of French too, so he didn't write in French. So the third choice that he had was Italian. Obviously he went to Italy, he was educated, he was a businessman, so he went to Italy and studied Boccaccio, so obviously he knew Italian, but he wanted to write to the English, to the masses, so he wanted to write in English. So the fourth option that we are left with is English. That is the language that he wrote Canterbury Tales in. But we have to remember that the Canterbury Tales is not written in the English that we know today. So this English that Chaucer uses is called as Middle English. So this is very different from what we know. There are many, many French words or the romantic words in these English, but it is really different from the English which we get in Beowulf, because Beowulf was a purest form of English, as Tolkien again tells that Beowulf is the English which is the purest form, because English at that point of time was purely Germanic. And when we come to Middle English, so there is this introduction of romantic words and also influence of romantic languages into English, which we get in the form of Middle English, and Chaucer's language is purely Middle English. The stories that we hear in Canterbury Tales are put by a mouthpiece by Chaucer. So he invents these mouthpieces and he puts his ideas through the stories told by these mouthpieces. So Chaucer has an agenda over here. Chaucer, what he does is he puts his ideas through these mouthpieces by the use of wit as well as rhetoric. Chaucer also tries to use irony and satire to reach his audience through these stories as well. Many of these stories are really radical to this point of time. One of the best examples that I could give you is the Wife of Bath, who is a woman, and again she comes to a pilgrimage. So this itself is a really radical idea at that point of time. In today's time, it really seems nothing, but when we look at Chaucer's time, it was a big deal. Chaucer attacks two main institutions in the whole Canterbury Tales. So these two were one of the greatest institutions and one of the most strongest institutions at his point of time. So one of it is the Roman Catholic Church. So the Catholic Church was a symbol of power, as well as he was fed up with the hypocrisy of the church. The same church that taught to be moral was wholly immoral. The priests sold out forgiveness for money. And also the second institution that he attacks was marriage. So in Chaucer's time, marriage was nothing but a man's thumb, which was only good for beating his own wife. So the logic at his point of time and the law at his point of time was such that a man can beat his wife if she talks back. So attacking this kind of institution at his point of time is really, really radical. So this kind of thing at this point of time in present day seems no big deal. So attacking this institution, but at his point of time, he could really get into trouble, and also he could be arrested for his radical ideas. All the characters in the tales of Canterbury Tales, we'll get introduced to them in this general prologue. It's a kind of trailer. So as in today's time, we get movies, and before the movies, the production companies release out a trailer in which the very, very influential and very, very important as well as very eye-catching sequences are put in, sewed together, so that we get to go and watch the movie. The same concept is what is used by Chaucer. So he introduces every character in the general prologue just like a journalist, as I just mentioned earlier. So he's more interested into satire. He starts by building up his audience. He starts by building up by every character and telling that how this character is. He tells out his characteristics of every character as well as the things that does. We'll have a plethora of characters, like we'll have a knight, we'll have a squire, we'll have a yeoman, we'll have a friar. So again, these are divided into like three classes. One is a nobility, one is a clergy, and one is a laity. So the nobility again refers to the people of high origin or the people who rule. The clergy refers to those people who are associated with the church, and the common people, which are again known as the laity. So these are the three groups of people, and every character that we are introduced in this general prologue fits into any one of these three categories that Chaucer tells. As I just mentioned earlier, so Chaucer is more interested into satire, and he plays this game from the very beginning of the general prologue. So most of the times he is telling one thing, and the thing that is happening is the other. So he uses this irony, satire, wit, and humor. All of these four ingredients are being used by Chaucer in the Canterbury Tales to make it more and more interesting, as well as this puts him into trouble, because many of the tales that he writes, as I mentioned earlier, were very, very radical and very, very offensive to many people. When that April, which is sure suit, The drought of March had pierced the root and bathed every vein in switch liquor, of which virtue endangered is a flower. When Zephyrus eke with its sweet breath inspired hath in every halt and heath, the tender crops and the young sun hath in the ram his half coran. And small fowls make in melody that sleep in all the night with open ye, so pricketh him nature in her courages than longen folk to goon on pilgrimages. And palmers for to sicken strange strands to fern halves couth in sundry lawns, and specially from every shire's end of England to Canterbury they wend, the holy blissful martyr for to seek that hem hath hopen what that they were seek. As we can look in this stanza that Chaucer wrote, this is the beginning of the general prologue of the Canterbury Tales. He uses vivid imagery of rural England. He tells that this is April, at the time of April when the spring comes, when birds come, when small animals come by to play. People in England go to pilgrimage to Canterbury. We find the mentioning of the blissful martyr. So the blissful martyr, as I just mentioned earlier, is Sir Thomas Becket, who was killed in the church. He was martyred in the church. So the whole imagery that he uses is of rural England, as well as Chaucer is trying to set up the tone for the introduction of characters. So he isn't introducing every single character now, but at the start he tries to set up this tone by bringing in the imagery of rural England. Billful that in the season on a day in Southwark at the tabard as I lay ready to wenden on my pilgrimage to Canterbury with full devout courage, at night was come to that hostel rye, well 29 in companion of sundry folk by adventure fall in fellowship and pilgrimages, where they all that toward Canterbury wolden ride, the chambers and the stables wherein wide, and well we wherein essayed at best, and shortly when the sun was to rest, so had I spoken with him every corn, that I was here fellowship anon, and make forward early for to rise, to take our way there as I would devise. This stanza gets very much confusing when we look at it a literal point of view, but when we look at it at a critical point of view, we get to see Chaucer's remarkable satire at the society of that point of time. So London in Chaucer's day was divided by the River Thames. In the south of London, so there was this hotel by the name of Tavern or Tabard that he mentions it. So again, this Tabard is a red light district, by the way. So he tells that there are 29 people with him, so who are going to this pilgrimage sitting in a red light district. So you can just see the satire that he is playing and the irony that he is playing. The people who are going to pilgrimage are resting in a red light district. So this is something that Chaucer likes to do. So this whole game of satire is being played from the start. So he tells that he is resting in this place and the next morning he has to go. So it is getting late, so he has to go and also rest. But nathness will I have time and space ere that I further in this tale pace, me thinketh in accordant to reason to tell you all the condition of each of them, so as it seemed to me, and which they were in, and of what degree, and eke in what array that they were in, and at a night than wool I first begin. Chaucer here tells that he has time now, so to tell about every single person that he is coming in. So he tells that I'm going to tell now about every single character, where they are from, what they do, and what they are going to tell. So he writes down this all these incidents as a journalist or as a memoir. So what he does over here is pure intelligence, as well as a very, very radical step that he is going to take. And again, he starts with a knight. So the character of knight and all, we'll look at it in a different video now. These three stanzas form the starting or the introduction to this general prologue of the Canterbury Tales. So till this point, Chaucer hasn't mentioned any single person. So he just mentions that there is this lovely weather, and when this lovely weather is all around in April, so people again think to go to Canterbury. So even I am one of them, and I'm sitting at this red light district called as Tavern in the Southwark of London. So there are people going to pilgrimage, but again resting in a red light district. So he tells that now as I have time, let me just mention every single person by their name and what they do. So this is typical Chaucer writing out introductions of people, putting it out as a trailer so that his readers build up an interest. So Chaucer, again, I'm mentioning it for the nth time, that he is going to take a very radical step, and also he is going to write really some radical stuff, which would again get him into trouble. But he again plays out this game that he doesn't know anyone of these people. He was just a fellow traveler who was writing these things, and he doesn't know anyone of them personally. So this was the most intelligent thing that anyone could do at his point of time. And Chaucer is again, without any doubt, one of the most intelligent writers and one of the greatest tricksters of English language. We today know that it was obviously Chaucer who made everything up, but people at his point of time believe that it was all a part of a pilgrimage, and he was obviously a writer or a journalist who was writing all his experiences while they were going to Canterbury. We'll be beginning with the knight, the squire, the yeoman, and all the other ones in the next video. Till that point of time, please like, share, and subscribe to Lit Critique. As well as, if you have any kind of doubts, don't hesitate to put them in the comment box down below. So this is Padmanabh from Lit Critique signing off. Bye-bye.